Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I'm joined in this second Caithness or Combat League Wrestling, I should say, edition of the SWN podcast by the Rogue himself. It's Lad Chapman. Welcome to the show.
Hello there. Good to be here. How are you?
I'm not too bad. How are you doing?
Amazing. Thank you for asking.
It's not like I've already asked this. We've already had this conversation before. This is just behind the magic.
We met 7 seconds ago, and no one can prove otherwise. The magic of theatre.
How are you?
I think, much like everybody else, we're doing our best in spite of everything. Just too busy, if anything. But it's all good busy. There's a bit of wrestling, a bit of work, and a bit of pool and a bit of streaming and trying to maintain a social and family life, and then you're just sort of like, urgh. And then it's like, don't look at the phone, don't look at the rectangle of sadness, don't do it, because you're just going to go to sleep unhappy.
Don't look at TikTok.
Red flag.
All I seem to do at the moment is TikTok. It's just like five seconds of joy, and then 5 seconds of sadness, and then 5 seconds of joy, and
I can't back it.
The cycle continues. Anyway, the first question on these podcasts is always the same. Well, this is the second question now, technically. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was the moment you watched? What was the thing that went, yeah, I love this pro wrestling stuff?
Oh, as a fan, you mean?
Yeah.
It was when I was PD, and I distinctly mind that there was a couple of videotapes in the house, and it was Mania 6 and Mania 8. What it was the Macho Flair affair, which I think was 8.
That sounds right. Yeah, I'll go with that.
And was the other one? Oh, was it Hogan and Sid? I can't remember. I mostly remember Flair and Hogan. Flair and Savage.
Oh, Hogan and Sid had Papa Shango.
Was that Mania 6? Either way, doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. Was these two videotapes around the house? Because obviously this was like, what? It would have been 1993, 1994. And we didn't have Sky until like SmackDown existed. So any wrestling that I took in was just like tapes that people had recorded on the pay-per-views or ones that folk had bought. It was all like Silver Vision. Mm-hmm. This is before Coliseum Home Video or whatever it is. Am I remembering right?
I think Coliseum was first, and Silver Vision. Now it's Fremantle, I think, that does
whatever
DVDs.
It is. And it's Silver Vision is the one. That's the ironically the gold standard from my childhood.
Oh yeah, absolutely. WrestleMania 6, Warrior Hogan.
That's what it was. Because I remember not like oddly as a child, I didn't like Ultimate Warrior. I was like, well, he doesn't do much, does he? I was like, you're 5. Just enjoy it. He shouts a lot. No.
A little mark in the making there, just going, oh, well, he doesn't, there's no work rate with Warrior.
The signs were there, they were there.
So that's, I'm quite surprised. I kind of put you in the same age as myself then, which I mean, I didn't start watching till the Arch era, which was when I started watching, it was 98, 99. So it's yeah, you've the whatever your features, they're youthful.
I might just expose myself a bit here.
I know. Well, usually when I'm speaking to folk and I kind of get a good kind of age range of what I'm thinking, most of the time it's all these young trainees now that have had a couple of matches and they go, well, my first memory was CM Punk when cashing in Money in the Bank. And I go, oh, no.
Like my first match I ever watched was 2011. And I'm like, I was, but like, how was it? I was like 22 in 2011. Oh, God.
Right. Oh yeah, we're not that
I'm
far away.
I'm sad
then.
Now. Can we talk about something happening?
But no, but I can't remember who it was who I spoke to, but they're going, they love Jeff Hardy when they first saw Jeff Hardy, and I was like, oh, cool, Jeff Hardy, cool. Yeah, when they had that feud over the world title with CM Punk, I was like, oh no, this is too far ahead, Jeff Hardy. I remembered him when he was like in 99 when he was down off ladders the first time.
We're living cliches right now, like beardy nostalgic wrestling fans. Oh, help me.
I love it. I don't mind. I'll go for nostalgia any day. Because speaking about modern stuff, you got either people that are just nostalgic about the past or they want to try and convert you to All Elite or something like that. And like, no, I'm quite happy with where I am. I will watch the cartoony stuff
here.
Exactly. I don't have to think about it.
I know what job this guy has outside of wrestling. He's a bin man. I know what's happening.
You say that. There was a wrestler up in the Northeast that was a bin man on the side, because I only know this because my dad worked with him and he was a bin man. And I was like, this is weird. Because he's Jason Rotunda was his name. And he offered training. He had a sign when he went through McDuff, had a sign that said former ECW wrestler Jason Rotunda, wrestling training. And he was former ECW because he was on WWE ECW and he was on one of the live in UK shows against Lance Archer.
Oh.
Or Vance Archer, he was there at the time. But yeah, there's a fun fact. And he was a bin man on the side. There you go. So anyway, that's an absolute ridiculous tangent. We don't need to go down any further.
That's good local trivia, though.
I know. It's so much fun when you do all this Scottish wrestling stuff. You find out some weird and wonderful things.
My computing teacher in school was a wrestler.
See, that's cool. Is he still a wrestler?
No, he was some gimp with a bowl cut. But then we found this out and we're like, you're the coolest man in the world. And he's like, can we not talk about this?
I was Cat Weasel, leave me alone. But now you get like modern jobs. I have Mr. P again. Most of my trivia is Northeast because that's where I am. But you got Mr. P, who's a techie teacher up in, and he works in WrestleZone. And I'm like, that's just madness that I would be doing, like getting told how to do a, I don't know, I can't name. I didn't do very well in technical because I can't name any what they're called, not joints.
Joints.
And then at the weekend he's batting folk with his elbow joints and it's just like, ah. Anyway, so favorites growing up then. We're gonna get back on track a little bit. So,
oh yeah, sorry, we were talking about things related to wrestling and memes.
Wrestling stuff. So Warrior was not on your
No, I don't know why
on your list.
Obviously being a child, it was just like, ah, Hulk Hogan, he's the best. He wins all the time and he's on about drinking milk and stuff and battering people. Yeah, I'll go for that. But then if you're like more things that would have been directed to like my specific taste as opposed to I like this guy, he's the best, like Jake Roberts and Ric Flair, probably. I like boys that just shit talked everybody. It was just like, he's just so clever. Like, why wouldn't you just poke somebody in the eye? Like, he's a genius.
that's the wrestling, the best bit is the story, isn't it? I mean, wrestling's good as well, but the stories that these guys kind of create outside the ring pull you into the actual moves itself. And Jake Roberts being one of the, and Flair being one of the premier guys that could do that.
When I was little, the curtain of illusion was still very much intact, which is why it annoyed me when people didn't do things that were perfectly sensible. I'm like, just move. Why wouldn't you? You're an idiot. I'm like seven, getting raging at the TV.
It's no DQ match. Bring a gun.
No disqualification, man. What are the police going to do?
I like that as the defense. And why did you bring a gun to the arena? No DQ, mate. That was
these were quite clear. He's a genius and my favorite wrestler, apparently.
Like the quite golden era kind of stuff. Did you ever have a break from it, or was it always, were you always kind of all?
Oh yeah. There was that period between. Let me think.
Eugene wasn't your cup of tea.
In my childhood, I don't think I ever watched like anybody around like the Diesel or Brett era. There was that distinct swap between there were loads of videos of, say, the mid to late 80s, and then there's a gap. And then everyone at school is talking about the wrestling. And everyone needs to get Sky. It's important.
I mean, was Channel 4 kind of your saving grace then? Because it seems to be quite common.
They had was it Rumble 2000 and a couple others?
Yeah, Rumble 2000, they had Fully Loaded. Remember that was on there. Armageddon 2000 was on there as well.
I would have been probably 10 or 11. I might have been too young at the time to stay up.
Sitting
there trying to find long play videos to get someone to record it for you.
That's the thing, because I remember, because I suppose you can call it tape trading. Really, I just borrowed my mate's mate bought the Sky box office. His dad stayed up, recorded it. Then I would get the tape 2 days later, and then I'd hand it back to him. And eventually I ended up getting all of them because he fell out of love of wrestling, and I was like, I'll give you 30 quid for all of them. And I was like, maybe 3-4 years worth of tapes, and I was like, yes, please, I'll have
that's
you.
That's a all. Library.
That is. I mean, if this is as much crap I can get away with in this house, because apparently I'm a grown-up at 31 years old, so I'm not allowed to... Not allowed. That's not, I shouldn't have over 300 DVDs and tapes hanging about in a room. Look, but
you've got to be passionate about something. Exactly. So you may as well be passionate sincerely.
Exactly. So it's unfortunately my whole tape library is in a loft in my folks' house. But no, you're talking about long play. Usually it was fine. 3 hours was okay, and then WrestleMania appeared. And it was like 4 hours long. I've got WrestleMania 17 over 2 tapes because I didn't know it needed long play. So my mate's dad had to stay up 2 nights in a row to record the first. Well, we recorded 3 and a little bit because they always give you a little bit extra. And then he had to wait to record the last hour on another tape. And it was, the kids these days, they've got their network and they've got their interweb and they've got their all that kind of stuff.
And they're fucking Nintendos.
Nintendos and all that sort of stuff, and we had to earn watching our wrestling back in the day,
timing it perfectly for the tape switch.
Exactly. So how did you come back to it then? So you missed all of the New Gen stuff, you missed Mabel and all the other classic superstars of the day back then. How did you get back into it?
I remember talk in the house, like between the family, of King Mabel, but not really having much of an idea what that was about. And then it was just everyone at school, very suddenly, can't pinpoint the moment, oh my God, Stone Cold is some boy. You've got to get your eyes on this. And I'm like, all right, okay. And I went, oh, this has changed. Oh, there's a lot of blood. Oh, there's loads of tears and stuff. Oh, everyone's swearing. Fantastic. Yep, give me this. And that would have been, what, 98-ish. And at that point, you know, like, especially in this country, well, everywhere, really, just Attitude Era, going mental for it, peak of the wrestling, and that's the point that everyone remembers, who's, say, our age now, who doesn't watch it, like, are Stone Cold still in it? And I'm like, actually, yeah, since Sunday, or Saturday.
That's the weird thing, because, you know, we're the same age in that respect, then, because when you go back and think about it, and watching Attitude Era, how did our parents let us watch like all that swearing and blood and all that kind of stuff? Because it was very risky, for especially considering the limits now you can get away with. Yeah. It's insane.
God knows, actually. It's a wonder we've grown up so well adjusted and happy.
Exactly, with all our stuff and things that we collect just to make us happy. But yeah, it was such a weird time. And so when you came back into it then, of course, Stone Cold, you mentioned, absolute the boy, as you put it. Of course, we just saw WrestleMania just this past weekend as of recording, and oh my God, that was the best whatever 11 minutes of my life, especially this year. It was just beautiful.
I hadn't watched any WWE in about a year. But the initial whisperings on the internet were Mania is really good. And I was just, right, I'm watching it. It's Monday. I'm not at work. I've had a false positive test. I'm waiting for a PCR result. I'm going to watch the whole of Mania. And I heartily enjoyed it. It was excellent. Like, everything you expected to be bad. Like, celebrity appearance, fun. Celebrity appearance, impressive, actually. Pat McAfee doing backflips, landing perfectly and no shaking. Stone Cold delivering a really solid performance and having loads of fun. And it was just, I had a cracker all the time watching it.
It's wonderful. And sorry, Carl.
I'm just very impressed. They can still do it. For all the slate and folk give them, you know, kind of quite rightly, mostly these days, delivering at a 9.5 out of 10 show, 2 days, good for them.
It's just one of those things where it's growing to... We're growing out of the audience they're targeting, so you got to kind of bear that in mind when you're watching it. I mean, sometimes it's still shit. I mean, I'm not going to say it's not, but I mean, for me, I just watch the pay-per-views. I'll catch the clips on YouTube because I don't have Sky or anything like that, or I don't have BT Sport or whatever it is on, and I don't have the time to watch Raw and SmackDown. Just give me like 5 minute chunks on YouTube every so often. That'll do me, and I'm fixed for the pay per view. Usually do the good enough job to do all the pre show and all that crap to get me up to date with all the stories. But it's just if you switch off for WrestleMania, did you watch both nights one day? Yeah. Or
I looked forward to the second one after I finished the first one in one day. Really easy watch.
I was a work day for you then, because it would have been 8 hours.
Yeah, well, that wasn't at work. So I was like, here's how I can occupy 9 hours of my time. Perfect.
Exactly. I mean, you'd already kind of blocked out before the old PCR test said otherwise. So I may as well just make most of it. So when you came back to it, though, who were your favorites? They said Stone Cold Steve Austin be one of them.
I was one of those people who just loved all the mid-card guys. I was like, Steve Blackman, Hardcore Holly. And like, you know, Val Venus, just D'Lo Brown, if they were like a mid-card guy who was like around that intercontinentally European-y level, I'm just like, this one's my favorite. Because I was like, why don't they get pushed more? Steve Blackman is the hardest guy on the planet. Why isn't he winning everything? And then you've just got, I don't know, I wasn't wholly into the whole main eventer thing. I was this weird mid-card mark guy. I don't know.
You know, Too Cool. I love Too Cool. They were just the best. I mean, of course, Hardys, which goes without saying, because I think anyone who's listened to any podcast I've done now will know that I like the Hardy Boys. Maybe too much. And your Edge and Christian Dudleys and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, when you're talking about those kind of guys, you had like Godfather. And for me, I still think the Right Censor was wholly underrated at the time. And even though I don't think anyone who was in the Right Censor liked being in it, I thought they were just the best. Val Venus with white slacks. All in. Give me that.
And Bill Buchanan, actually. What a wrestler. Just busting at things a man his size shouldn't have been doing.
But he was way ahead of his time. Imagine
if he squared himself.
A guy the size of Bill Buchanan doing all these kind of... Keith Lee can never. Bill Buchanan was just the epitome. Test. Albert. Oh, man.
Keith Lee's lucky. He's intellectually superior. Bill Buchanan would be coming for him. That's all I'm saying.
Exactly. So were you always a WWF guy or a WWE guy? Or did you dabble with the WCW?
No experience at WCW apart from the PS1 games, and that was it. And I don't know why. Maybe it was just it wasn't on the channels we had, or I don't know. But everyone I knew was just WWF. I didn't know anyone who was a WCW guy.
I think it's just because it's more readily acceptable and accessible in the UK, I suppose. Because all these stories, when I'm speaking to folk about them, and they're like, "Oh, we waited and waited for Cartoon Network to shut off." I didn't know Cartoon Network did that. Didn't know it cut off and went to TNT at 10. My WCW was Channel 5 and watching Worldwide.
Like on Sunday afternoons, where when someone got hit with a chair, he came up with a
bang. Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, that's my only experience with WCW for years. So when it came to like Invasion time, I was like, I recognize Sean O'Hare and all that kind of and Mark Jindrak. I recognize these guys. And then you have the bigger guys come in. I'm going, I have no idea who that is, because Booker T, no, he wasn't on Worldwide, so I've never seen him.
And then he went on to be everyone's favorite.
Of course, everyone loved a bit about Booker T.
Unironically, top five ever. I mean, five joke, but.
Oh, is your shucky ducky?
A little bit. I'm just putting my phone on silent. Sorry if you heard that. There we go.
I didn't hear it, so it's fine. So magic. So when you came into it and you came back to it, the Attitude Era, at its height, you loved all the weird and wonderful characters that they were coming out with, like your Val Venus. Again, we're 10 years old watching a apparent male porn star. For some reason. We're seeing Rikishi with his arse hanging out and all that kind of stuff, but we're still allowed to watch this for some reason. I don't, at least if you go back now and if you had a child that age and that was what you were watching, again, like you're saying, how did we come out so well adjusted and normal? A question mark?
Standing question mark? Smile?
Madness. So how'd you go from that then? Because this is a quite a big leap and jump. how'd you go from that then to go to finding out about K&S Pro Wrestling at the time? Finding out about that and then going, I can give this a go.
Well, there was another gap at some point in high school where everyone just kind of floated off of wrestling. And then there was a part, like, it wasn't a part of my life for a long time. I had no idea, no concept of who John Cena or Brock Lesnar were, you know, as an example. And then we were grown-ass men who had left school and had jobs. And someone mentioned they were going to watch Mania because something cool was going on. I can't remember what it was. And we somehow got into this routine of every year for Mania, just dressing up as wrestlers around town, getting blutered, and then going back to somebody's house and staying up until like 7 in the morning and walking through town when it's dead quiet on like a Monday morning, steaming, dressed up as wrestlers to get home. And then, oh God, how old would I have been? 2014 it was, I think. Dodgy. My flatmate at the time had somehow found out about the fact that this chap from Thurso, Dave Hobbs, was he'd come back home to stay and had learned wrestling when he was down south somewhere, I think England, and was going to start teaching people. And he's like, oh man, it should be magic, let's go. And I was like, oh no, it seems really like greasy and sketchy. I don't want to get involved with that. Like, it sounds like fun, but yeah. And in the back of my mind, I'm going, you want to get fit and the gym is boring as fuck. This could be quite a good way. But then I'm like, this sounds really greasy and sketchy and weird. Why does no one know who this guy is? And it's just like, whatever. So then my friend will be going for like 3 weeks and he's like, no, come on, it's magic, right? You need to come. Okay, I'll give it a go. There's me like 9.5 stone soaking wheat going up and trying this. Okay. Got absolutely battered on my first day. It was this shitty, dilapidated shell or like a burnt out corner shop. And there was like a functioning door and everything, but you could tell the stuff had just been slapped onto the framework of a building to close it up. Like the roof was just like these metal rails. It's like, oh no, it wasn't even, so for the first little while, but then I really enjoyed it. It was really sore and the first ring we had was awful. And Dave was like learning how to actually be a coach, how to pass on information effectively. It was such a ridiculous ragtag affair, but it was exciting. So that's kind of how it started, was in the rough framework of a clapped out building that leaked.
Nothing helps your thought of it being a bit sketchy. Just a guy's come up from up down south and wants to show you how to wrestle, and nothing puts you on edge more than going and see a dilapidated building creaking open and going.
The thing was, if my pal hadn't gone initially and gotten me to go, I don't know, the last 7 years would have been a lot different. So
I know. I mean, the sliding doors, you might not have seen your pal again. the whole side of sketchiness of it,
I'd still be alive, so I didn't see the problem here. That'd be his fault.
I know, yeah, he went to the creepy building first,
idiot. Why did that?
so were you aware of any like a Scottish scene at all, or was it just a case of actually, no, before we get to that bit, who did you dress up as for WrestleMania?
I was Chad Gable 1 year.
That is an interesting choice. I would not have expected that out of any wrestler in the world. I thought Macho Man.
Because I was like, I've already got this college jacket knocking around, and spray paint the towel seems like fun, and I can just take my hair and go, hey, and then we're there. It was achievable, and like mid-card Mark guy strikes again. I was Grandmaster Sexy another year. I can't remember. My costume didn't come home 1 year. Who was I meant to be? There was something that I was going to be, but it didn't come home. So I ended up having to just like wear a luchador mask and make up a character. It was something really dumb, and I can't remember now.
We've all been there. I ended up going to a Halloween wrestling show, and I just looked like an absolute nonce at it. But I went as, because you got in for free, or you got a money off your ticket if you came as a wrestler.
Yeah,
but I came as I was going to come as Honky Tonk Man, so I bought an Elvis jumpsuit.
Help!
And I bought a wig, but the wig didn't arrive. So this is what I look like. and with a honky tonk man Elvis kind of suit, and I had it like V cut all the way down.
Oh, what a great!
And I had a Sin Cara mask, thankfully. So well, thankfully, and I just went, I'm the honky botch man, and I was like, yeah, Mark. And that's
almost a save. I'll give you a point for it.
There's a photo of it somewhere, which nobody wants to see. But
still clearing yet? No, we've not.
And yeah, it was when I look back on it, I realized I was sat in a crowd of kids with essentially my tits out and like hairy chest and all that kind of stuff. It was not a good look when it came down to it in the end.
I mean, the fact that you acknowledge the scuffedness of that situation tells us all those kids were safe, but still, Jesus, that's an image. Cheers.
I was very aware of the situation. I was like, I'm not going to move. I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to sit in the corner and watch the wrestling and hope that nobody oh shit, they've taken a picture of me. Oh no, this is the one that goes on in the paper, isn't it? Wanted man. There's our year went as Hulk Hogan, NWO Hogan, but I didn't think how I was going to put the mustache on. So I had a couple beers at this point. I thought, you know what? Chewing gum. That would do. So chewing gum put on top of my existing mustache. And that was a horrible day the next day. So trying to get that thing off and trying to get the chewing gum off as well. So
there was one year that Connor had dressed up as The Rock, and this was when he was fully bald. And I think it was like the boots to asses period. I can't remember what t-shirt he was wearing. But he had the full-on latex bald cap. So we were walking through town at 6:30 in the morning. I'm ripping hair out of his head, getting the last bits of latex off before he goes to bed. And his head's like bleeding and he's nearly like greeting. I'm like, come on, let me have it. And we're just sweaty because we've been in this guy's house getting blurred for like 14 hours. And he's just got these latex right through his hair. It's like, oh. I swore I'd never do that kind of thing. And I never have, thankfully.
No, dressing up as a wrestler would be silly. No, but no, it's what we do. That's what we do as wrestling fans. We just kind of make it of ourselves, and then
we are cringe, but we are free.
So we're all in this together, as they say
in
High School Musical. We are just all for one for all. That's not High School Musical.
Good reference, cheers.
Yeah. What was I asking before? I wanted to know who you're wrestling as.
How we got started with Cadis Pro Wrestling. How we got from being a wee fan to being a wee guy trying it.
Right, we'll go with that then. Yeah,
that's where we were.
So you were in this dilapidated building, ramshackle with the.
It was so bad. If you jumped too high, you would get tetanus off the fucking rails. It's great.
So how did you go from that then to Dave going, you know what, we're gonna set up a show, we're gonna get people to come in.
Let me think now. I'm trying to. There was a weird wee timeline. Did we go straight from? I think did they start off in the assembly rooms? Actually, it's just across the road. We did some shows in the assembly rooms. It's like a local venue, just a town hall-y kind of thing. I think they were in there for a little while before I started. Then it was the shop. I can't remember if we went straight from the shop to the Boys Brigade Hall, and that was a really good little bit for it. It was excellent. It was just a nice medium-sized hall, could fit maybe 60 folk and the ring, and it was our own space. It just stayed up all the time. It was excellent. That's what it was. One of Dave's friends was like restarting the Boys Brigade, and he was like the captain of it. It's like, oh well, boys, I've got a little venue here. We can help you out nice and cheap if you help us kind of run the Boys Brigade and everything. So then Dave somehow got involved with that, I think. So we had this perfect little space. Roof was still a bit low. You know, 450 attempts were in short supply. But yeah, so then once we get into there, I think things got a lot more structured. People went, oh, this is a thing now. And people kept on coming and giving it a go. And I stuck around and more of our pals give it a go. And as our fundamentals improved and everyone was just sort of cobbling together an idea of how to do it, Dave's learning how to coach as he was teaching us, and we were learning how to not murder each other and try not to be like horrible little backyard guys and do it properly and But no one really had a clue of what we were doing. We were just throwing shit at the wall and seeing what stuck. I can't remember how long it had been running before I started, but I distinctly remember my first match, because someone had gotten hurt, was 8 weeks after I started.
That's a bit nerve-wracking then.
We got through it, and folk enjoyed it, and nothing went wrong. It was mainly just do these like three things and nothing else, and we'll get to the end, and it'll be fine. And it was.
I remember where I was going before. It was. Were you aware of any of a Scottish wrestling scene before you even?
God, you say that. I'll tell you, the only thing I knew about was occasionally, if you were around the place, you'd see posters for. I'm sure you'll know the company name because I don't.
I'm gonna guess it's W3L.
No, it was. It was that company who did the really, like. The really obviously fake like tribute shows.
EPW.
Maybe you'd have a guy who was like dressed up as Bane, not Kane, or the not Rock, Dwayne Jameson.
Okay.
People were just dressed up as the wrestlers that people focus on TV. It was amazing.
If it's like a really long time ago, then it was, I think it was, they were called WFGB. How they got away with that, I do not know. But they ran Elgin as well. And
that
was
my only, I had no idea that other companies existed in the present, like in the present day. When I started with Kids for Wrestling, I was like, so what else is there? And this is when I learned about the little map of who was where and what they were doing. And then we started like getting in touch when making pals with these people. And yeah, it was only when I started actually trying it, I found out there was this thriving ecosystem. And we were lucky enough to get started at the beginning of like that boom period.
Of course, yeah, because I think I was speaking when we were talking to Connor about it. He was saying like 2014 time, and that's when the ICW documentary came out, and that's when it really started to boost, and people were just running to the shows and what have you. So
I'm not sure how orchestrated that was on Dave's part as far as timing went. It may have just been luck, but he may have seen it and gone yes. Because the dates for me are very lost in time a bit.
Sorry, I do have some notes, so hopefully I can jog your memory in bits and pieces. However, Cage Match will go as far as back as late 2015, which is conveniently when I started covering Cave Mess Pro Wrestling. So I'm not saying Cage Match is lifting results and not crediting, but they are. That's what they're doing, and they're not. I tried to set up an account with them. They didn't get back to me. So I'm like, you're lifting results off me, and just nay, let me play. Let me add some wacky tag teams that people don't know about. That
I'm phoning the policeman. That's what you could do. There's a oh god, which Facebook meme page is it that always steals them? Is it Ringside News that always steals memes from the groups and then watermarks them? Anyway, there's a guy who's been like hiding watermarks that are like, Ringside News stole this meme inside his memes. And then people are like, ah! they're leaving a what? You know how like packs of money and banks have that ink inside? That's what he's doing, but with his shitpost. Amazing. So that's what you should do.
I'm going to put in some dummy ones. Yeah. Put in just some random serial killer names in the results and just see if it gets picked up. So you made your debut then. You made your way through it. Three moves.
So
all good. You're alive. Your opponent's alive after just about.
It was in front of about 25, 30 people.
Well, that's like,
and that felt like 50%. WrestleMania, 50 billion, 400,000 people. Like the adrenaline rush of doing something so stupid for the first time. It was just amazing.
What was the look? Was Lad Chapman already kind of on its way, or were you just? Because I think Connor was saying he bought gear for his first match. It didn't arrive, so he had to go to Tesco and get a pair of black tights, black t-shirt.
Basically,
and then,
mine was like a black compression undershirt thing with a white vest over it. So it was like mid-length black sleeves with a white vest. It was the ultimate, like, create a wrestler looking wrestler. Some long black trousers and then some roughly boxing-ish boots that were like black material with a white sole.
And that was your promo picture for a wee while, because I now you're going through that look. I think that's probably one of the first pictures I saw.
I switched out. I switched out for a baggier version of the black and white. I was like, I kind of like this. I don't want to be looking too over whatever. And then I think that was me just totally coping about the fact that I didn't have nice gear going, no, I actually prefer this. As opposed to like not having something nice to wear, which was totally my own doing. I think I was scared to commit. You know, the whole fear of failure thing. Mm-hmm. If I go and get really nice gear and then it turns out that I'm rubbish at this, then people know that I've made an arse of it. But if I just sort of only half care and I make an arse of it, then I wasn't really trying, was I? It's fine.
That's cool. So. It was just a laugh, right, guys? Just a laugh. So the name then. So Lad Chapman, which makes me laugh anyway because it's three words that are the exact same. If you added boy in there somewhere, it's kind of runs it up.
Lad the boy Chapman.
Yeah. Or like I know David Boy Smith, Lad Boy Chapman. No, actually, that's the thing when I roll it out there. Lad Boy. So what was the inspiration behind the name? Did you come up with it, or was it a brainstorming session?
No, I just stole it from a nickname in high school, conveniently for Connor, because in high school, he had this weird tick where he couldn't go more than one or two sentences without calling someone, oh, here, lad, or chap, or herman. He could not do it. He couldn't speak without calling people lad or chap or man. So we just called him Chad Lapman or Lad Chapman or Man Lad Chap. Any combination of those words, that was one of his nicknames for a while. And I started wrestling first. And I went, that's a great name. So I just messaged him, I'm taking Lad Chapman and I'm going to copyright it and make £8 million with dumb t-shirts. Fucky. And what? He couldn't really say no because he wasn't wrestling. So then he turned up and had to make up his own name like an idiot.
Universe, he's Lad Chapman.
So Lad Chapman is a stolen high school nickname for Connor.
Connor would have been training at this point then when you were kind of making your debut, or did you drag him along?
Just kept on talking about how much fun I was having and kind of bothered him into it because he's one of these just broad-chested, naturally strong guys. So as time's gone on, he's gotten way stronger and way fitter, but he looks like really similar, just an angry barrel that throws people around. But now it's like all muscle. Thing is, so I think the plan was to get all trim and Mr. Universe, but just for me bothering him until he gave it a go. And then he really enjoyed it as well. And he kept coming and I kept going. And so then we just kind of went. But it was just me harassing him until he gave it a go to make me shut up.
Oh, that seems like a good way to...
I'm really good at being annoying, Billy. Let's be frank.
So we do have some questions. We've got quite a lot of questions. So we'll sprinkle them in as we go along. We've got Ora Fortuna. Is asked,
oh, yeah, yeah.
What's some aspects of wrestling that you found challenging?
I did spot that one, and I thought about it. And I was like, well, body image, obviously, because I'm just a pipe cleaner / bottle of milk human hybrid. So initially going in and having to be seen in a ring, just looking the way that I certainly did at the time. I've got, you know, a bit of tone now, but when there's a white light on you, I'm just like, you know when Mr. Burns comes out of the forest when he's all radioactive? The I bring you love, that wee guy, I look like that in the white show lights. Until I got good enough to have a bit of self-esteem and realize that looking like that can be an advantage. I was really, really self-conscious about that. But the other main thing was, oddly enough, there's the whole like interlocked destinies thing of me and Connor. He was a really reserved and frightened guy of like being in front of people, but at the same time, he picked up the actual technical aspects and fundamentals much better than I did. But my wrestling went, I want to be this kind of wrestler, I want to be that kind of wrestler, I want to learn this, I want to learn that, da, 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 and didn't get anywhere. I just ran in circles. But being in front of a crowd, I was quite happy. I could be a clown, no problem at all. I could arse a rune, sit and chat to folk, no problem. So I had the personality he had the wrestling, and the other, like, we each lacked the other's strength. So yeah, like, actually, wrestling in general, executing wrestling in a way that was good. I'm very slow initial learner, but my skill ceiling is, like, really, really high. Like, if I get hyper fixated on something, I get really good at it, but it's slow for me to get there. So yeah, probably, like, the body image thing, which I'm sure everybody gets, considering the kind of wrestler you're used to seeing. Until I went, no, I'm going to weaponize my emaciated alien man body and make it into money.
But that makes total sense when you're talking about that. You have the character down, maybe not so much wrestling, but the character bit down when you're talking about who your favorite wrestlers were. I mean, yeah. with the exception of maybe Steve Blackman, who wasn't the most charismatic chap in the world.
But he had cool music, though.
He did really, really cool music. That I will not deny. it was the best. And he had nice red shoes as well. But yes. So yeah, so that makes sense. That, I mean, when it comes to wrestling, we've already mentioned that the way I like it anyway, it's not so much about the wrestling, it's about the character and the story anyway. So you can hide a lot by being charismatic.
I got away with a lot for a long time.
So I made some notes of matches that I kind of wanted to bring up, and you said your debut, guessing 8 weeks after you started training, so what was that, 2014, 2015, if that?
It would have been, I think, the middle of 2014. I think it was the summertime. I'm not a keep a diary of every match I've ever done guy. I'm thinking about my next one guy. Mm-hmm. I can remember my last half dozen kind of thing. I don't know. I'm not the kind of person who's going to sit and look back through my campaign logbook over a glass of brandy when I'm 50. It's just, I don't know. It doesn't interest me.
Okay. Hopefully you remember the matches, though, because the one that
mentioned them well.
Oh, cool. That's fine. The one that jumped up straight away was 2016. So very early on. And you wrestled DCT. So
I did.
So 2016 DCT, was that International Sex Hero DCT? Or
he was wearing the, you remember the Andre style singlet, but it was like leopard print.
Right. So yeah,
I think he recently started wearing that.
Yeah, just after his orange gear with the mustaches on it. So it was just after that then. Yeah, so that's, I mean, as far as opponents, at that point you would have been wrestling mostly just CPW guys.
The occasional import here and there, but DCT was the first one that was like someone that I really knew of and admired, you know? So then it was just like, okay, he's coming up, yeah. And it's just like, and he's wrestling you, I'm like, right. So it's a mixture of fucking yes, this will be great fun, but also, oh no, I'm gonna make a complete dick of myself. I know it. It went fine in the end. Everyone had a good time. Everything was fine. But that initial feeling of, oh god, I think that was when I realized that I had to really start to have some self-esteem and plant my feet a bit and go, here's who I am, here's what I'm doing. Or folk are going to start thinking badly of me. I can't be this sort of wet flanloa guy because I already look like a wet flanloa guy. So it was a very, that, like, before and during that show was a really formative time in a very short period of time. It taught me a lot, I think, about different, like calling things in the ring. I'd never done it. It had been like a year and a half, and we'd always just like, because it was just us and our friends, we could just go, right, okay, yeah, boof, and then just go in and do it and not really talk to each other that much. But this was someone new, and he was like, well, this is how I do it. I was like, well, we'll give that a go. I'll see if I can learn. And I did. So it worked out.
I tell you, he was once someone you admired then. So like we established, you weren't aware anything that there was Scottish wrestling. It was a thing at all. And then once you started training, you find out there was like this network around, I suppose territories, if you want to call it that, around the country and elsewhere around the world. So how did you kind of ease yourself into that? Was it simply just getting onto YouTube and finding everything you could, or did you travel to shows? How did you kind of immerse yourself in Scottish wrestling and UK wrestling in general?
Well, the problem is, at that time in my life, pretty much all of my money was taken up with going to like Glasgow or Edinburgh or Dundee and visiting friends and getting blutered for weekends. And there was always something to be planning, something to be doing. That's where the money went. And on the occasion there'd be a show on that weekend, we'd go to it, but going for it wasn't really a thing. It was mostly through just like, I'm a nosy whore of a boy. I'll just go around people's social medias, their YouTube, everything, and just go, what are they up to? What are they doing? And then just like observe until you actually meet the person. Then you can go, right, I know you, what you do, this and that, which mostly people are like, oh, that's really nice that you know. A couple of people have been a bit sketched that I already know most of their moveset when we've never met. They're like, how do you, and I'm just like, I'm just nosy. So I just like wrestling. So I'm interested in your wrestling because we were about to like meet and stuff. And they're like, right. Just like, okay. Sorry, I didn't mean to make you feel, you know, a little bit intruded on putting things out in public.
So when you got the match DCT, then that was you kind of, you immersed yourself in DCT for whoever it was through social media.
Oh yeah, just whatever was online. I just went, right, give me all this. But then admittedly, he's a much easier study than most people because it's just like, scoop slam, done. There's like, scoop slam, have magic crack. There you go. The rest of it, we can just work out together.
Can't go wrong. I mean, I finally saw him wrestle just a couple of weeks ago. I've never seen him wrestle live before.
Really?
No, I didn't see him until he did the Regal Rumble for WrestleZone. And I watched, he was announced for the match. And I was like, have you ever seen DCT wrestle live? And I was going through, because I am a Sado that has the matches. I run a site that has all the results so I could check. And I was checking back going, nah, I've never seen him wrestle live. This is just unusual. So, but yeah, like you're saying, it is a very easy night, I think, if you're wrestling DCT, because it is scoop slam crack.
And you're guaranteed good quality. That's the thing. And that's what, like looking at it now with more seasoned, capable eyes, it's like very easy to work with, guaranteed good quality. And you can just, there's a lot to work with. I had a lovely time.
So and from that,
well taken care of, considering how bloody green I was.
I mean, he came up quite, I think he was kind of thrown into it really through the old WrestleShark stuff and all that kind of thing. So I think he had a bit of a rough go getting to where he was. So I think he knows how to treat someone well by the sounds of it, which is, it's always a good thing when it comes to wrestling. But the 2016 kind of started properly, like Caith Ness Pro Wrestling was a bit more noticed because there were booking guys from like Air. You're getting like your Bobby Roberts, you're getting your Robbie Wisharts, your Vipers even were coming up all the way to Caith Ness. So did you find as you started it was still quite new? Did you find that was as these guys were coming up, the crowds are getting bigger, were you able to kind of take it in and see the evolution of Caith Ness Pro Wrestling?
It was around that period when it started to become like, it felt like, the word doesn't work, but it felt more like something we were building as opposed to something we were doing for fun. It's like, oh, we can make this into a real thing instead of just, because we started with the intention of it just being, well, in my mind anyway, I don't know about Dave, because like generally I was like, my job is to do wrestling and I'll do that. And as long as I'm having fun, I'll continue doing that. The administration isn't my concern. I am the staff. Like in the ring. But for me, it was just like, oh, it's nice to have a community thing the kids can look forward to. We'll do this and that. We'll get involved with local events doing this, but mostly as a bit of fun. But then it was around this period when we started doing like the assembly rooms and we were like getting, 130 people, 150. Ooh. And then it was like, oh, people are kind of getting into this. We could like start to really and make it a proper thing. And the ones from down south really were a large part of that. I think it helped to kind of kick us up the arse a little bit and take improvement more seriously because we were seeing it done at a level that we weren't capable of at the time. And we went, ah, that's what it should look like. Okay, got it. No problem. So that was kind of like we were like the uneducated natives discovering civilization. Like, oh, all right, okay, yeah. And we started to improve pretty rapidly at that point.
Was this the point where you went from not like it's a hobby kind of thing, going, oh, I'm not going to fully commit to this, but when you started seeing these kind of the community getting really involved with the company, was this the point where you're like, right, I'm going to get myself some snazzy gear, I'm going to go all in on Lad Chapman, or were you kind of just building it at that point before this kind of boom happened?
It was weird. Like, I've always had a problem as far as gear goes. I think now that I've got like the nice jacket for the entrance, I still just like basic tights. I think it might legitimately be that I just like basic looking in-ring stuff. But at that time, I did get some slightly nicer ones, I remember distinctly. And I looked less scuffed. You could look at someone and go, this person does wrestling, as opposed to this guy is possibly wearing a costume. It was like, no, it was obviously a wrestler. But it was mostly in the actual in-ring quality. Because it was just watching them, realizing this chasm of ability, and just soaking up every bit of information. You could just glean out of these people. So the problem was, we were having quite a lot of fun at the time. Like, people would come up and go, oh, we're excited to see you. Hi, friends. Would you like a tin? That would be fantastic. Oh, no, it's show day. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Right. Okay.
And then it turns out, like, you learn quite quickly to wrestle hungover. Only happened a couple of times, but yeah. There was a period where we had to get specifically warned not to drink on, like, the Friday or something. Because, like, you know, everyone has that period in their mid-20s where they're just mental, unstoppable dynamos of, I'm going to have as much fun as I possibly can at all times. So this was around that period. So our abilities were flying. We were meeting new friends and we were having more fun than we probably had room for. The candle was very much both ends.
Then you hit 30 and hangovers become two-day affairs, if you're lucky. Tuesday might arrive and you go, no, I'm still dying. I'm still wanting to die here.
I'm not as bad as some, but it's still by like the late evening, you're still feeling it. But I think it's worked out for the best. Like, I'm in the best physical shape I've ever been when I'm 32. And I can only see it still improving as we continue to like, we'll get to the current day when we get there.
Yeah. I apologize to anyone who's watching this. I think there's really crap weather out there. And I think this light is dipping, so at some point I may just be plunged into darkness and that'll be a very weird part of the interview where I try and look for my ring light and then I just appear in the shadows.
But just dub in a bong and then everyone will go, oh my god,
exactly, we can do that. So yeah, this kind of boost then, we're saying with all these, I'm really noticing how much it's flickering now, it's annoying me, but with this boost you got in the ring with more experienced opponents then, so you got your Glenn Dunbar, you got your Robbie Wishart, so the kind of it goes in with your thing of new friends, new experiences. Oh my god, I can maybe call myself a professional wrestler to people now.
Accurate, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll just say you also had Lucha DS as well and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. You had a fair cavalcade of opponents.
Yeah.
But one, I will just go all the way up to, you wrestled in Orkney.
Yeah.
So, as far as it goes to Caithness Pro Wrestling and highlights of your life, what was it like getting to wrestle in where you came from up in Orkney?
I couldn't, like, it's the kind of thing that it felt so much more significant to me because it was in Orkney and it was the hometown and everything. The guy from the radio, from BBC Radio, phoned me and was like, do you want to do an interview on the radio for BBC? And I was like, you mean BBC Radio Orkney? Yeah. So I was like, right, okay. I was in like a cafe in Glasgow at the time, I think. It was like, boys, I've got to nip upstairs for like half an hour to find a quiet bit near the toilets and just sit and speak to this guy about... And then obviously he's giving you the usual questions that whenever someone who doesn't know about wrestling asks you about wrestling, is like, oh, is it this? Is it that? And then like, so I'm like, I wish I could just give this guy an open-handed slap right now. But it was fine. Being able to like go out in front of, we got a huge crowd. It was like, well, for us, obviously, a huge crowd. Like 300 people or something. Like there's bleachers and stuff, and there was all lights and everything. And I was out in front of like a lot of my like my extended. I nearly used the word hillbilly, but I've used it now. Family were there. And I've got like the Orkney flag, and everyone's like, oh my god. And the announcer guy's like, from Kirkwall, and they're like, ah. And I was like, this is the kind of thing I'm gonna tell 18-year-olds about in the pub when I'm nearly dead, and they're not gonna believe me. I can't remember which Orkney show it was, but there was one night it was like there was a tournament, and then there was a rumble, and then it had a match with Dunbar at the end, and it was like over an hour of wrestling, and I had a broken thumb and a concussion, and I nearly died. But the two times I went to Orkney are my favorites. Tip top, easy. Like there's no contest, because it's just got that touch of magic for me that it wouldn't for others. But
like, yeah. It's like you're a celebrity for that amount of time with doing the old BBC interviews and what have you. So for that was your WrestleMania, going out and getting 300 folk to.
Yeah,
so absolutely batshit crazy to hear you're from Kirkwall.
Well, it's like looking back on it, like I think 6 months ago, I've recently had this thing about allowing myself to be happy about things and like enjoy things and like buff other people up. Just since like before Christmas, I've stopped, like, you know when you've done something good or you remember something, but the back of your head's always like, don't get up your own arse, or whenever you say something nice about yourself, you always like add a little bit of taking the piss on the end so folk don't think you're a smart arse. You've got this little, it's a really British thing, just so folk don't think you're up your own hole. Nobody likes a smart arse. But I was like, nah, I'm switching that off. I'm sick of that. And so, it's a silly thing to folk who are obviously a lot more established in wrestling, for me to get excited about something so relatively small and feel so proud of it. But then I'm like, no, fuck you. This was really special to me. So I'm going to really hold on to that and really feel fantastic about it. And even though to a lot of other folk, it might be insignificant, but it's something I've really been taking into helping people at training with recently. But we'll, same thing, current day, we'll get to that when we get to it.
The thing, you've got to appreciate the little things, even if it's, Like you said, in the grand scope and whole world of things, it's to other established wrestlers, it'd be like, oh, just, that was, what's the old Street Fighter thing, kind of thing. It's for you, it was this big moment. For them, it was just a Sunday.
Juliet playing M. Bison in the film.
Yeah. So just I'm trying to paraphrase it, but yeah, for you, it was a massive moment. For them, it was a Saturday kind of thing. Yeah. It was just one of those things. But no, you're. You did that, and then, of course, the moments kept coming, because then you won the Caithness Pro Wrestling Undisputed Championship on your birthday as well. So your run in CPW, of course, was full of these moments where you were like a rock star for the night when it came to CPW. What was it like winning the title? So if I mind right, well, I say I don't mind right because I wrote it down, but no, I haven't. I haven't wrote it down. That would be... It was vacated that evening, and you were against Lucha DS for the vacant title.
Yeah.
So what was it like when, I don't know if you were told beforehand or if you were just said, go enjoy yourself and the result happened, because I know that seems to be a thing for some reason in wrestling. What was it like being told that you're gonna be the top guy in CPW?
I had no idea until the moment that a hand hit the mat for a third time, because for ages, right, I'd always pigeonholed myself mentally into this sort of always the bridesmaid, never the bride kind of thing. Like Lad Chapman would always be the finalist. He'd always be the guy like getting nearly there. All of, like, the Pride of the Highlands tournament, I think I was second like three times out of five times it happened or something stupid. Or I would get really close to succeed, and then it would just get ripped away. And I was like, oh, that's my position, is to be the sympathetic character of nearly succeeding. until that moment. And I was like, oh, because that, I remember getting really knocked off in the car. But I've worked my bollocks off. I've improved so much. And there's people who are objectively shitter than me who are succeeding. And I'm like, I understand, but I just need that validation once, like a shake of the hand, like, good for you. And then I didn't know that this was happening. And folk were sitting there like, I can't wait until this happens and we can laugh right in his big, stupid, beardy face. So I just kind of sat in the back, knackered and confused. And then we went to the pub.
It didn't last long, unfortunately. I think it was the next show, possibly, that you ended up losing the belt. But
a rumble, I believe.
Yeah, I think you're against Russell Adamson, I think. He won by DQ, and then there was a rumble next that you end up losing the belt or something like that. But, you know, you had the moment. Again, it's these moments. Did you wear the belt when you went out afterwards for your birthday?
No, because as much as I might give the... give off the aura of being a fuckwit, I'm not a mark. It's when it comes to sort of like when it comes to game time or show time, I'm very much on the ball and tactful and professional. Like, you put me in a meeting room, I can do very, very well. But a situation like this, I'm just a total goblin, which I'll have to I'll have to put my hands up and admit.
Right, so you could have rocked it, but yeah, I'm going to guess that there was also the slight possibility, maybe chance of it not coming back, the belt.
It's more that I think, like, for me, it dips a toe into that ocean of, oh, that's a bit cringe. Mm-hmm. Like, I wouldn't want to be that guy that sits and goes, ah, look at me and look what I did. I'm like, well, no, it's a little bit too over that line for me. I think that comes into the fact that as much as I want to, like, buff people up and help them learn self-esteem over bravado and really keep people feeling good about themselves, I'm also horribly judgmental. So that kind of falls into that. I'm like, I wouldn't do that. If someone did that, I would want to hit them. So I'm not going to do it.
If Connor went to you with the belt afterwards, you'd just spend the whole night just roasting them.
Just like, you doing? Yeah.
So of course, got all that. You also made your appearance down in Respect Pro Wrestling in 2018 against Connor. I have discussed it with him as well, but it was like it didn't end DQ. That was him against Eric Arkham. What was it like getting to wrestle outside of Caithness and being out of that little, like, that bubble in the north and wrestling in front of a brand new crowd?
I mean, by that point, we were kind of comfy enough with the idea of everything and what we were doing and feeling more like people from down south are more like colleagues that we can learn with and from, as opposed to just like being, oh, hello, sir, can I get some advice on X, Y, Z? It was more like, you know, like, we're also part of this group. So that was nice to have sort of felt that personal improvement where I'd feel comfortable viewing the situation like that. So instead of being a bit nervous or anything, it's at the point where everything feels like excitement for fun, as opposed to feeling frightened. So it was great. Just had a nice time. We were invited down to go and do our thing for a night and have a bit of crack. It was great. Unfamiliar crowd, obviously a different part of the country, being able to sort of adapt a bit more and get out of the established way of, like, our county-based stuff. It was nice to get to sort of work in a different environment and go, right, okay, well, we can do X, Y, Z because we can't do that at home, and we can do this here. I think that's the most fun part about wrestling, is judging the situation and where you're trying to go and then going, oh, this presents the opportunity to do this, which you usually couldn't. So that's fun and exciting.
There's the ceiling's a bit higher up. We do some 450s now.
Well, I personally can't and wouldn't, but, you know, could have. What was that social club called in Kilburnie? Anyway, no, it had this weird, like, the roof was really low and, like, a big square, and then there was, like, raised bits, and there was one square of slightly higher roof in the center. So if you didn't go at a certain angle, you were still hitting the roof. And I remember it was mirrored as well. So I remember, I distinctly remember locking eyes with some old wifey in the crowd behind me when I was on the ground. And I was looking up at this angled mirror and she's behind me. And I can see her staring into the mirror, looking into my eyes. And I was like, oh. Just this 2 or 3 second surreal moment within the violence. It's like, okay, no, I've got wrestling to do. And then just shake the head, get back into reality. But you know, some people just unsettle you a bit. Particularly, I mean, at wrestling shows.
I mean, old people are quite unsettling in general, but
it's horrible.
I've been to enough wrestling shows to, I've been unsettled by crowds, and I'm just sitting in amongst them. I'm obviously not always dressed as Elvis, as a fat Elvis with their shirt off. But, you know, wrestling fans are, we're an interesting sort.
A cultural melting pot.
And some, Niall,
please give me your money.
So some melt more than just the pot. I've been next to some absolute hungers. Anyway, I don't know their names though, so it's fine. They're protected for now.
Judgmental.
I know. Yeah, we are two peas in a very judgmental pod. Now that you've mentioned
people
it,
are like, begging, yeah.
Yeah.
Anything else? No.
Like hand sanitizer. No, when we brought in the hand sanitizer at shows now because of you know, COVID. I'm not saying that they should have went one step further and put a wee thing of deodorant, but you know, wouldn't have been the worst idea in the world. Right. So CPW, of course, then 2019, it came to an end. How much were you aware of its kind of finishing, closing? Or was it a case of, right, we're revamping, this is it, this is the last CPW show?
I think it was a cup. I could easily be wrong. This is something that I definitely don't know with any certainty. It might have been a couple of shows before we wrapped up Kathis Pro Wrestling. That we knew that that's what we were doing and where we were going. I can't even remember what we announced to people and let them know. I just remember we definitely knew at least a show or two in advance. So we could get it all laid out and ready. I couldn't even tell you, Billy, I couldn't even tell you the gap between the last Kathis Pro Wrestling one and the first Combat League one.
I think it was that long.
Not a notion.
Because it was end of 2019 was their last show. And then the season for Combat League was like started.
Oh, it was the start. Yeah.
Started in 2020. I think and it was only got one show in. Yeah, and they only got one show in because then, you know, Corona happened.
Oh.
So at that point then, because again, from a chat with Connor, it wasn't a case of, oh, that's the last show, there's no wrestling anymore up in Caithness, that's it over. There was already kind of rumblings and plans
that
Combat League was happening afterwards.
We were really hoping it would be a way to get more people across the door. Like our established fan base would keep coming because it's wrestling. But if this format gets taken in with the league and the points and the teams and the da-da-da-da-da, that it might get some more folk who go, ooh. We were aware it was possibly a bit of an XFL thing where you get this weird like crossover where the wrestling fans don't like the league part and people who might like the league and scoring system wouldn't like the wrestling part. It kind of worked out. But no, we knew we were, that's what we were kind of paving the way for.
What was the kind of thoughts on that last show then for Caithness Pro? I mean, because like saying you knew this next stage was coming, but was there still a bit of an emotional night where Caithness Pro Wrestling was no more afterwards?
There was the bit at the end of any wrestling thing where there's someone in the ring and they're talking and mic and everyone's like, oh, and everyone's coming out and everyone's, oh. It was that moment, that period of like 15 to 20 minutes. And I was there like, I'm still very much Lad Chapman. Like, I can't sit here and get teary-eyed and smile and wave. So I just basically stood there, my arms crossed, looking grumpy for 20 minutes and just taking the piss. But it was admittedly quite a difficult thing to do. My main memory of that night was I came out from behind the curtain at some point when Dave asked me out of the ring, and I still had my glasses on, and like four bairns went, ha ha ha! You wear glasses. And I was like, I'll take them off then. My feelings are hurt now. And I went, actually, I'm leaving. No, come back. Just, that is my main memory of that night.
Get roasted by kids.
Billy, who did I wrestle that night? Help me.
Someone who would have been organized to have had that information from me, but I will go get it. So, okay, there. Pro Wrestling. Which you can all find out more on swnscotland.com if you want to find all the results.
I might have to go and do a nostalgia troll. Because now you've got me thinking about it. And I'm like, oh, this information would be useful from a practical point of view. More than a sentimental one.
It's random, the last show. That was August. That doesn't seem right, does it? That doesn't seem right. Hang on. I was to be honest, I was stretching cage match for that second there because it's easier to find. Keith Ness, Pro Wrestling. This is fantastic for everyone that's listening and watching. Let me try and find this. Retribution was the last show. Right. Excellent. Ah, screw you, Germans. November 30th, 2019. You opened the show against Scott McManus.
Yeah. I was like, I thought it was him. He's brilliant fun to wrestle.
Well, that was quite a good looking show. It was quite a good mix of folk. Of course, you had your Taylor Vites and your Angel Hazes and all that kind of stuff. And you had, of course, Glendon Barr and all that kind of thing. So it's quite a nice little mix of originals and some.
I can't say enough good things about him, by the way.
Glendon Barr. It seems to be a very common occurrence. Every time I mention Glendon Barr, it's always so much praise for the guy.
Well, like, I think he was the one that kind of brought me down to earth and went, look, stop thinking about cool moves and think about how to do a headlock properly, please. Here's how you do it. And we spent like 20 minutes just talking about a headlock. And I was like, yes, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to be the fundamental guy who just talks loads of rubbish. So, and that's why I don't really do flips much anymore. And my neck thanks him for it. I mean, nothing's wrestling, Dad.
Nothing's more effective than that, than a good old fashioned headlock. So from that point onwards, then, because we mentioned Combat League and all the kind of plans. Again, going back to the chat with Connor, which you haven't heard because it's not gone out yet, which is great for
people to actually remember it. I really do.
He was kind of saying that it was kind of discussed, and he didn't. He maybe had some ideas thrown in there, but he doesn't know what was actually pulled out of it. But, was there any ideas that you kind of thrown in with the kind of hybrid style of the point system or the wrestling rules, or were you just kind of a case of, cool, I'm still wrestling next year, that's cool, that's fine by me?
There's a lot of things which are very, like, because we are very tight-knit up here, like, everyone's just kind of, it's a different kind of environment. Like, down south, a lot of people wrestle at companies for themselves, but there's some other companies who are, you look at a certain person and you know that they are for that company, like, in the same way that everyone up here is just for our thing. So if there's an idea coming or whatever, we'll have a chat about it as a huge group and just go, what do you think, does this work, has anyone got any ideas we can tweak it to improve it for it, no effort, da, 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 da. There's a lot of diplomacy that goes on with everyone as a group, which I think is fantastic, because it helps people feel kind of valued if they're a part of the decision-making process, you know? I mean, by and large, Dave just deals with everything himself, and he's gotten very, very good at it. But on the occasion that he needs help with something, he'll just come to everybody and go, what do you think? And then we'll just go, right. Brainstorm, blue sky thinking, other things that people talk about in wanky offices.
Synergy.
Yeah, that's the one.
So it's a nice team effort overall.
That's what feels so good about it, honestly.
So before we go into Combat League and all that stuff, we've got more questions, so we'll just rattle through them because they're a bit more off topic when it comes to it. Because, of course, then we had COVID and Twitch and all that kind of stuff. There are stuff you do outside of the wrestling, so yeah. We'll cover that in this little tangent section. So we've got Damien Ryans. He asked nice simple question. Do you really like Heinz beans?
Yes. Thanks for your question, Damien.
Excellent. Moving on. we've got Struan McKay.
Oh, yeah.
Who I think I just figured out, because he's Struan TNBTIW. And I assume it's like the next best. Shit, I had it in my head before we even started the recording.
I don't know. I think it's the next best thing in WIC, but I don't know. Or in wrestling, possibly. I don't know.
The next best thing in, because I had it, was like, well, that's quite clever. And then I tried to do it now and just absolutely fucked up entirely. But he's asked, Struan, love that name. It rolls off the tongue quite nicely.
Yeah.
What's under the beard?
Dark eldritch forces, as yet uncomprehensible by the mind of man. That sounds good. Let's go with that.
Go for that.
Yeah.
Here, Chuck Norris, underneath Chuck Norris's beard is another fist.
Oh, God.
No, that's it. I know, I was going to say, how old is that reference for that I made there? That was a meme when I was young. James Dowes asked, yes, what is Lad Chapman's favourite episode of Will Jim Drink It?
Fuck off. Right, Will Jim Drink It was a thing that we did like 5 or 6 years ago, I think. Every Monday night, it was pool night, and at the time I was running a pub, so I didn't have to get out of my bed until 10:30 in the morning. And our pool team, our captain is called Jim. He runs the gift shop across the road from my house. And he's a good whack older than the rest of us. And he's just a bit of a character. But on Monday nights, we'd be sitting drinking, and Jim would only ever drink rum or very occasionally Malibu. And we're just talking bollocks. And we're like, okay, we need to broaden his palate a little bit. I want to just try him with some stuff. And he's just sitting, just talking nonsense. And we're like, ooh, we could make something out of this. So we're like, right, 20-second video. You just got, like, my friend, like, Harry, go, Jim, Red Aftershock, will you drink it? Nah. And then like, Pelican will pop up, oh, tune in next week for another episode of Will Jim Drink It, and that's it. And then, over time, it went beyond these, like, usually it'd be, will you drink it? Yes. Tune in next week. And we did that 4 or 5 times. Then it got arms and legs, and they got this overarching story, and we started expanding the format and editing and all this mental stuff. And it was like 3 or 4 years we did it for. It was really dumb, but I loved it. So to answer Dow's question, my favorite episode was the one night where we asked Jim if he would drink it about maybe 14 or 15 times in 3 hours. And he had most of it. He had like a dozen shots and all his rum on a Monday and went home gutted. But Jim is the kind of man who claims that he doesn't get hangovers from rum, but he does from cheese. So
I mean, I've had a cheese hangover before. It's not fun.
It was just it was called Tuesday Monday. We'd just end up going home at like 5 a.m. on Tuesday mornings, steaming after pool. So
there we go.
Well, we were doing really good. We were getting like 1,000 views at least every video.
Wow. I mean, will Jim drink it in the?
It's gone Facebook page. It's go and watch it. It's so bad, but like in the way that makes your soul happy, because it just reminds you of a very nice time of your life.
Yes, well, there you go.
We had a theme song.
Was it just music or was there lyrics?
It was just will Jim drink it, will Jim drink it, will Jim drink it, Jim.
Right, hang on. Let's find them. We're gonna do this now. Let's find it. Well, Jim drink it.
It was just a local guy who's in a band called Pure Grief, from Peter. He just went, lads, I made you a bit of music. You what? Here, you've got a theme song now.
300 likes on Facebook.
There's 500s, there's 700s. One got 1,000, but 1 got 1,000, we were so happy about it.
Right, okay, we're gonna play it now.
Oh no. Oh, that glorious phone speaker sound through the microphone.
That's fair. Oh, okay. So yeah, that's the recommendation for everyone. Go watch Will Jim Drink.
It's been dead for like 3 or 4 years.
It's still on Facebook though, so you can go check it out.
Forever. I think we'll get a Christmas special sometime.
Right. So that's our little like avenue out with wrestling for a moment, because of course, COVID happened. When did you start doing Twitch streaming? Was that during COVID or do it right beforehand? What's kind of story there?
This is like my metamorphosis from a mega social normie guy to being an internet degenerate that streams anime mobile games. Me in 2020 and me now are vastly different men. Like, Jesus. Oh God, our work went on furlough because we're in a workshop, all touching the same machines. You can't be doing that, so we were closed. And it must have been, it was the back end of May, so it would have been at 2 months in. And then I was just scrolling through Facebook, and there's this mobile game. Like, look, we've got characters from Guilty Gear. Do you know what Guilty Gear is? It's like a fighting game series. And it's all the characters are references to like heavy metal music. There's like Dizzy and Zappa and bloody Saul Bad Guy. And he's like a reference to Freddie Mercury and all this stuff. And the music's amazing. And the art style is amazing. Folk who know what Guilty Gear is will go, ah, this decade's got some taste. But folk who don't know, that's what it is. Fighting game, music references, very cool. And they're like, ah, oh, our game has a collaboration with Guilty Gear. And I'm there like, okay. I can shoot stupid anime characters in the face with characters I like. I'm going nowhere for 2 weeks, at least. Right, okay, download. And I was like, oh no. It's one of these predatory microtransaction-y kind of games that are very cleverly designed to try and squeeze a couple of quid out of you here and there. Oh well, that doesn't, whatever. Not free to play. I'm quite enjoying this. The art's quite good. The game's pretty decent. I bet folk are streaming this on Twitch. We'll go and find some weebs. They'll be playing it. And they were. The first stream I ever watched was this guy from Northumberland playing this game. And I made friends with him. And then he was like, well, I'm done. We're going to go and visit this guy on his channel. He's Korean, but he's living in like Sheffield or somewhere. We're going to go and visit him. And I went, Kate. And everyone who played this game was really, really sound and really fucking nice. And they were like, oh, you're from Scotland. You've got a stupid voice. You should stream this. And I went, right, I'll give it a go. So then every Saturday for like, well, most Saturdays, if I've had like a wedding or a show more recently, I do it on the Sunday. But at least once a week since maybe June 2020 until now, I've just streamed this game. And now I've got a little community and I'm running tournaments and I'm helping commentate tournaments. And if I go onto like people's channels on Twitch and I just have a chat, people go, oh, it's you, I know you. And I'm like, how? So it's I've dug out this little niche in this weird anime community and I've learned a lot about like global culture and different people, and it's mental. It's become a very positive part of my life. Like, obviously the start of 2020, if you'd said to me like the online anime mobile game community, I'd have laughed in your face. And even now I still do, even though I'm part of it.
Yeah, it's a weird thing because I mean everyone seemed to go through the same kind of things when it came to the pandemic. You kind of settled on one of them. It was like you either made bread for a bit, you did Twitch, or you did a podcast. And yeah. I tried Twitch. And then, of course, then most of the wrestlers I created on 2K20, I couldn't use anymore. So I went to podcast instead. And here I am since then. So, yeah, it kind of allowed people to explore online community, hopefully in a safer environment as well. So it's like you're saying, it's expanding your culture and your horizons in the comfort of your own home.
I've learned how to commentate stuff. I've learned editing. I've learned like how streaming actually works. And like community moderation and this and that and the other a lot of little skills have just been picked up along the way. So it's been a very, I think I made a lot of hay while the sun was down.
I guess the word, yeah, that's the phrase. So we've got, we do have a question about it. Well, kind of a little bit about it.
Yeah.
From Daniel Mechka.
I don't know if it's Mecha or Mechka or what.
Mecha, that might be more accurate. Anyway,
In advance, I've got to apologize to Dan because I only call him Dan. I've met him in person twice because it's Albion de Quincey from Combat League is his friend. So he's been coming and then he's gone, oh, this is quite good fun because he's a big wrestling fan. He does a football podcast, in fact.
Do you know the name of it for plugging? Do you know the name of his podcast?
It's got the word balance in it, I think. I'm going to check it right now. Wait.
Just putting you on the spot there.
Give him a little... No, it's fine, because I'm sure Combat League actually shared something to do with it.
We shared it as well, because it's very rare that we get reviews that are
from
like,
up here, yeah.
Yeah, so I was like, definitely sharing that.
So that's how I can get to a thing about his football thing.
Balance the... something. Again, great for content here.
I'm going to his Facebook. No, this is your house. This is your barbecue, and it tastes good. That's all I'm saying. The perfect balance. That's what it's called.
Perfect balance. And yeah, you're right. When you said balance, like, I recognize that. Yeah, perfect balance. Yeah. It's like a 20-minute review of the latest Combat League show. So if anyone wants to go check that out, they can do. It's on YouTube and the like and all that. But anyway, yeah, his question, it was a really, really good question. Like, this is the sort of things I would never think to ask. So thank God, Daniel, that you did it, because I wouldn't have. So he asked, as a wrestler who also does Twitch, what did you think of the whole debacle surrounding WWE wanting Adam Cole to stop streaming before he left for AEW?
That question has a lot of moving parts. I can understand, like, from a business side, like, they wouldn't want him to do it in case, like, while he represented them, he obviously did something inappropriately or got into some kind of DMCA hoo-ha, or... But if they're not directly controlling him, I can get how they wouldn't want him to do it. But then you've got the argument of, well, it's his free time, he can spend it how he wants. Like, in that situation, I feel like if it was me and someone wanted to... if my work wanted me to not do something like that outside of work, I would want to be paid for that time being not my own. But obviously, there's a thing about when you're in a company like WWE, you'll be always on, always representing. So I can kind of... I'm very much be your own man, entitled to the sweat of your own brow kind of type. So I'm really glad that recently that they can do these third-party things again. Obviously, after they've gone through the company, but they can do it.
Yeah. I don't know if Twitch is on that list again. I know Cameo is. I think they were talking about Cameo and all that kind of stuff. It's loud, but...
I don't like the idea of a company owning a person so much as that. Mm-hmm. It feels personally uncomfortable.
Yeah. I think it's a weird thing with Adam Cole. I think it's a weird thing with Adam Cole is that's his real name. So if it's for a case of, up, up, down, down, Xavier Woods, he's Xavier Woods on TV, but on up, up, down, down, he's Austin Creed.
Yeah.
I can see where there would be a lot more of a, well, he's not Xavier Woods while he's doing it, so he should be allowed to do it. Whereas Adam Cole's got that weird kind of middle ground of going...
Adam Cole.
Yeah, he's Adam Cole. So is he the character or is he Adam Cole? It's a weird thing, but no, it does seem like they're calming down and.
Yeah, well, obviously their business philosophies are generally different in most places. So it's the kind of thing that I don't know the ins and outs of it. But my general feel is I don't like the idea of someone being told what they can and can't do with their free time when he's just playing some games. But then that's kind of... Even then, if you're a famous person, a Twitch channel is a brand. So I can kind of get the company office side as well. And
it's just one of those things where, you got to weigh it up. You don't know the real position that you'd be in until old Vince McMahon goes... Well, he wouldn't do it, but Vince McMahon turns to you and goes, no, you can't do Twitch anymore because you're representing the brand and the brand doesn't do that kind of thing. It's just, a weird way, but a fantastic question, Daniel. It was just an excellent one. As soon as I saw it go up, I go, geez, that's never thought to even think about asking that sort of thing, especially when, like yourself, you're on Twitch, every weekend. Yeah. Fantastic. Combat League, where I've realized that I've had you for about an hour and a half now, so we'll kind of try and get more recent stuff.
Right, let's go. Come on.
Before we do that, though, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Ankylosaurus.
Oh, nice. And I love it, just came straight off the top of your head. And what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
What's the motivation?
That's the question. I don't have anything further information for you. You got to You create the rest of it with your imagination.
Okay. So do they have any prep time?
That's the question. To sheep versus one cow.
Right. I don't have prep any more. Time, no prep time, cow wins. Prep time, sheep win.
Fair enough. That's fine.
This is a Home Alone situation.
Fair enough.
It is. Or Batman, whatever. But I'm not a superhero guy.
Oh, that's fine. I mean, I am, but we haven't mentioned any of them so far, so I wasn't even going to broach into that subject of superheroes. Although we were speaking about mirrors earlier, I was going like, oh, it's like Moon Knight, but I'm glad that we'll move on. So Combat League Wrestling. Combat League Wrestling returned.
Yeah, sorry.
Of course, they returned for one show, and then, of course, the world ended, so they restarted again in 2022. What's your thoughts on the kind of the rules concept? Is it just intriguing to you, interesting? Does it make you have to structure a match differently? How does it work? How do you find it works?
There's a lot of little pieces that make it really fun. Like, my personal two favorite rules that we've got are, in a tag match, if one member of a team leaves the ring, the other team member becomes the legal man. It just moves and moves and moves and moves. And it lets... A lot of people who've been in the tag matches have used this rule very creatively in their matches. And you don't really clock what's happened until you're like, they're so smart. It's like one guy can just cheat like buggery and just go, nope, I'm away. Partner in, becomes the legal man. The refs have got to be on their toes, but they do a good job. The other one is the public warning system. There's no flat DQ straight out. It's you get two warnings and then you get disqualified. There's scope for a lot of monkey business, a lot of shenanigans and bastardry. It's excellent. I love it. It's a straight advantage to people like me who just want to make an arse of people. It's great. You can just, like, you can use them tactically in the same way that, like, a batter in baseball might use, like, balls instead of strikes. Just go, nah. They're totally just a free space. Do what you want. Here's how you can cheat for a minute. No problem. I've got it. I understand the strike system.
I hope they start putting some of their shows online just because I want to see this. I want to see a bit. KNS is an alpha drive. It's an alpha drive away to get there, or shows that are Wick and all that kind of stuff. But I think because they used to have they had quite a lot of the KNS stuff on YouTube, and then of course that got all scrubbed when they closed and restarted.
Yeah, we have a couple of fixed cameras so we can watch them back and debrief and get feedback for training purposes. But actually, like a proper video feed is something I think we would need to. So it's a really common thing. But our worry is if people locally know that they're going to get to see it anyway, they might not come physically. So this kind of worry that it might like affect attendance. If people are like, oh, I'll just wait 2 months and I'll watch it on YouTube. So it's like, considering how small our catchment area and population is, getting 180 is tough. Mm-hmm. So like if we lose 20 people because they're going to go and watch it on YouTube later,
I mean, as someone who's done Scottish wrestling for so long, I wish I kind of had like the nuts just to go to companies and go, just give me the link. I will review it. I will not share it. Just, I want to see this. So, if the guys at Combat League are watching and they want it reviewed, give me a shout. I will easily do it and not share the links.
I mean, even if it was screen shared and we could discuss it while you watch, that could be an idea. But I don't know. I'm not the boy in charge. Yeah. I'm a violence monkey who insults kids and their dads. That's my job.
Speaking of that, we've got real Pilkey. He's got a question. Does Lad Chapman still consider himself a hashtag rogue, or has he gone clean since joining his house in CLW?
I've got to apologize to Pilkey. I had expected a question making a complete dick of me, but that's a great question.
Questions in this particular episode have been just ace. Even question about Heinz beans. You know, it's all been good stuff. Well done, guys.
It's the idea of the whole team system has introduced some weird shades of grey in, like previously, like my motivations were just, I really like a good scrap. My favorite thing is to stand on someone's throat and go, haha, I'm better than you, and just being a bit vicious and horrible. You can't really do that in a world where you've got to consider other people and the requirement for points. And, you know, and the well-being of a team in general. And then when we go coming back after COVID, it's like, oh no, now I've got to consider the well-being of the company at large. Like, local businesses couldn't open, they struggled, they've died. I covered this all in the video leading up to the show. So now the well-being of the company as a whole is like my main thing, as well as getting my team to the top, where I firmly believe that they're the best set to actually be in charge of Combat League. So it's like, there's a noble cause of protecting the company and helping it survive and thrive. I'm just getting there in a bit of an unwholesome way, basically by battering everybody to make them as strong as they can be, because a company can't survive without good wrestlers. So if you just prepare them for the worst by presenting them with the worst, they're just going to improve. So you're welcome. So the wrestlers get better. We keep selling out. That's thanks to me.
Not quite a rogue, but you're...
It's kind of... I still really enjoy being horrible. It's really fun. Just kicking folk in the face and kicking them in the bollocks and poking them in the eye and just choking them and just making fun of fat dads and their goblin bairns. Nothing better in all the world. But now I've just got to consider a greater good while I'm doing that. I'm accomplishing something nice while still being who I want to be. And there's a bit of nobility in that, but, you know. I'm not quite a monster anymore, but I'm also not quite a, you know, I don't think the ends justify the means or anything, but, you know, I'm not quite just, you know, the worst. There's a bit of goodness in there.
You're kicking folk in the balls for freedom. That's what kind of
doing.
Yeah.
Like we've got bums on seats. Tickets are being sold. People are improving. And if I get to be viciously horrible to achieve that, everyone's winning.
So your team, of course, Captain Taylor Veit, you're such a captain for the team, and you've also got Albion De Quincey as well. So a very new face.
Yeah.
In Scottish wrestling, so you're kind of in that middle ground of, I'd say you're the most experienced in terms of training and years wrestling. Taylor's probably got a bit more on you for like experience
actual
with different companies. And then of course you've got Albion, who's got no experience until now. So it's a nice little mix when you're kind of putting this team together, and when you're seen, sorry, not when you're putting, when the teams are put together, and you see that is your team, is it straight to the old messenger or Discord or whatever, and getting everyone involved and going, right, we can do this as part of House Stag, we can be a
mostly
bit...
It's just when we see each other physically and have a sit down and a yarn. I'm not altogether the kind of person that'll sit on like a group chat for ages and just sit and I find it's really difficult to communicate through just text like that. It's like, I'll just wait until we're together and then we can, you know, have a chin wag.
Yeah.
That's what I prefer anyway.
Cup of tea and a strategizing.
Yeah.
And all kind of thing. Excellent. So we've got 10 points at the moment on the board as of recording. I don't think there's a show in. I think the next show's May anyway, so this will be
the back end of May. 26th, 28th.
So this show will be out well before then. So you've got points on the board, but not near the top just yet. How are you finding the point system? You've mentioned kind of how you've kind of adapted to the actual rules and what have you, but with this whole point system thing, is it still just getting used to it? Is your three shows overall, two shows into this season, how you find the whole point system in general?
It's got just enough flexibility. There's a little place where you can get 6 points here or 5 points there and get these little jumps ahead, and there's opportunities here and there to pick up a couple of extra so that you can just leapfrog a little bit. I like it a lot. I'm feeling quite comfy with the idea. I think if I wrestled in other places, if I was like, okay, this week, I'm doing here, next week I'm doing there, and then there's a Combat League show. My brain's going to have to totally to work with our rule set and freedoms that it affords to really maximize what you can do with it. But because for us it's just the standard, it's fine. We're nice and comfy. It's mostly the ones who come to visit us that I imagine would struggle with it. If they would at all, they're generally clever people. So I've not heard of it being a problem yet. And I've seen them using it to great effect. So.
So we'll kind of move on to some wee fancy stuff before we hit, as of recording, the old fancy, big 9 o'clock. The old fancy stuff. So, of course, you wrestling now for a good number of years. Take out that bit in the middle with the old COVID stuff. But have you got any aspirations or any opponents that you want to, or even companies that you're wanting to get to in the next, say 2 to 3 years that you would love to travel down to and do a bit of wrestling with?
In actual like practical terms of something that would realistically happen, no, is the honest truth. Like for me, this is it's a community thing and we're building it. So like the kids have something to look forward to and we're getting involved with this and involved with that. It's very much a thing about the county and about the town, and having people come up and visit is lovely. Because they get to have the much more like creative freedom kind of environment, and they say they have a lovely time. Maybe they're lying. I don't know. I'm very gullible. But everything that I do in wrestling is based towards, is directed towards improving the company and our perception around here and helping the community stuff. And I don't have big dreams, like getting to the big time, yeehaw, nothing. Like, not even, like, going down south to wrestle, because, I mean, if someone invited me, was like, here, we've got a spot on our show, are you wanting to come down and fill it? Then really, absolutely, yeah, that'll be good fun. But I've not got any, like, my targets are helping Combat League succeed. That's it. It's not like I'm wrestling to do it as a lifetime, full-time career and be this journeyman that goes around and wrestles in Germany, Japan, and deepest Romania. No, it's just like, I'm helping this company be as good as it can, and that's kind of it. There are people rounded about the place that I'm like, oh God, I'd love to wrestle them, but I'm not going to sit out to do it because I've got enough, like there's the work and the wrestling and the pool and the streaming and the social life and the family life and, you know, attempting to find love in this deep dark abyss that we call Caithness. So it's like, how do you like fit all that in as well as going, oh, I'm going to go gallivanting across the country indulging in this flight of fancy? You can't do it all. So I'm just realistically going, okay, I can have a real impact on what we're doing here. So my brain doesn't really go off too often. If we're watching something, I go, oh, I'd love to wrestle Zack Sabre Jr. If we're watching like New Japan Cup or whatever, or oh, I'd love to wrestle XYZ guy on AEW or WWE, it's like they wrestle in a way that I think I would have a lot of fun with. But I've not got like a dream anything or a plan or whatever. It's just like,
yeah,
I'm doing what I'm doing and it's going well and I'm having fun. I'm very grounded and practical in that way, you see.
Well, I mean, the last question we ask folk outside of social media—that's not—that's like your appendix question at the end. But we are asking folk if Vince McMahon again. Vince McMahon's brought up a lot of times in this podcast. I thank you for watching, Vince. Your stunner cell was amazing at WrestleMania. he's phoned you. He's went, hello, lad. He's very Scottish. He speaks to Drew quite a bit.
Lad Chapman, it's me, Vince. What's the crack?
fit like. So he's booking you in the main event at WrestleMania, and he's giving you a full scope. You can pick the match stipulation. Your opponent has to be alive. I don't. It doesn't matter if they're almost dead, but it's like alive. Any stipulation. So it could be opponents. It could be anything you want. You've got the full control. Who would it be, or what would it be?
Why? I don't know. Let's just have me and Connor Rose on the moon and a C4 on a stick match, and we're both bollock naked or something. Inevitably, it's going to end up being me and him, and the cockroaches left after the bombs fall. So,
WrestleMania on the moon. Write that down.
The one place capitalism can't touch, space. I don't know. Me and Tanahashi in a being best friends match because I want him to be my friend.
Just hug for 5 minutes and that's it.
The winner is everyone, especially me. It's one of those things where I don't really sit and fantasize about it too much because I'm just like, it's not a, oh, you shouldn't think about that. Don't let yourself dream kind of thing. It's that it doesn't enter my mind.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, you're quite one track mind going, I'm here to build Combat League. Outside of that, cool. But
yeah, I'm like, free to think as magically or as stupidly as I want. It's just in this, I don't.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Basically, yeah, we're me and Connor going to continue to knock the bollocks out of each other. And well, the phrase I used in my video leading up to the show was, this doesn't end until one of us retires or dies. And there's got to be an element of truth in that. So,
yeah, okay.
Also, realistically, hopefully. He's like, I want you to come over from Bonnie Scotland and kick fuck out of each other. I'll give you £8 million. Like, no bother, Vince. I'll get on the plane.
Get on the plane. I look at the prices going, oof, that's a fair scalp to get over there.
Like, I've not got my £8 million yet. I can't do it. I'll have to pass.
You have to pay £1,000 over before he'll release the £8 million, of course. I mean, he has sent this to you in a spam email. And with that, so thank you very much for joining me on the podcast.
You're extremely welcome. I had a good time.
Where can people find you on social media if you're wanting people to find you?
My Twitter is at Scholomania. It's mostly shit posting. I think my Twitter crack is incredible. You probably won't. I'm into a bunch of weird shit. I make stupid Tekken videos and stuff. I don't know. But, you know, you'll see some wrestling, you'll see some streaming stuff. You know, if anime chebs happen to be your kind of thing, as apparently it is mine, I didn't know. And quality crack. Lad Chapman is on Facebook, so have a teat over there. Oh yeah, if you're on Twitch, give me your Prime so I get free pints. Thanks.
Well, that's the way to end it. Thank you very much.